Now, the cardiovascular system is what we're starting here. And pretty much each of those bullet points is its own chapter. We're doing the heart first. The vasculature are the blood vessels. The blood, the liquid tissue, the blood, life-giving blood, is its own chapter too. But we're going to do it in this order. So the cardiovascular system, its job is to circulate blood. Simply put, that's its job. And today we're going to be studying the muscular heart, which is a pump that generates pressure to push the blood into the blood vessels. The heart is a muscular pump. That pushes blood forward into the arteries. Now everyone knows that the heart pumps blood. But let me give you some numbers so you can appreciate the job that it does. And the average person, and when I say average person, kinesiology books usually mean like a man, 5'10", 175 pounds, something like that. Okay, but the average adult cardiac output is about 5 liters per minute. Just put a number to it. That's how much blood the heart pumps. And it pumps it, and it circulates, right? You pump blood out, and it comes back. It goes round and round, all right? And we'll learn how the blood circulates through the body. So that's what we call a cardiac output. That's the term. Now, something you can directly measure in yourself, with like a radial pulse or a carotid pulse, is the heart rate. How fast does it beat? Beats per minute? About 75, okay. And with each heartbeat, how much does it push out? It's about 70 mLs. So we call that the stroke volume. The stroke volume is basically how much blood is ejected into the arteries per beat. The volume of blood ejected into the arteries per beat. So if you multiply 70 ml, 75 times, it get close to like 5 liters a minute. Okay, so these are the basic numbers. You know, and every time the heart beats, the heart must first relax to receive blood so that it can pump blood. So when the heart is relaxed, the heart muscle is relaxed. That's called the diastole. It's receiving blood. The chambers are filling with blood so it can pump it. Okay. And then when it actually pumps the blood into stroke volume, that's called the systole. When the heart muscle contracts, like when you studied skeletal muscle contraction, it basically squeezes. You're like squeezing blood out of the heart into the arteries. That's how the pump works. The ventricles fill the blood and it beats. So, So how many times does your heart beat on average? About 75. Now you can take your own pulse rate, right? You know, a younger person is probably closer to 50 or 60. So this is one cardiac cycle, one beat, about 75 per minute. In that one beat, one cardiac cycle is about 0.8 seconds. Okay, that's one heartbeat, one cardiac cycle. Now, of that 0.8 seconds, about 0.5 of that is diastole. About 0.3 seconds is systole. So that's really how it breaks down for the heart. And we'll go through all this again in the cardiac cycle. That's what we're talking about, the heart. It pumps blood into the vasculature, which is the blood vessels. A vessel carries something. The blood vessels are simply containers for blood. There's three basic kinds. I said the arteries. A good rule to remember, an artery will always carry blood away from the heart. They distribute blood to your body. Okay. Another kind of blood vessel is the capillary. They're the smallest blood vessels, and the walls are so thin, they actually allow exchange of blood gases and metabolites. I'll just call them an exchange medium. Now, to push blood from arteries to branch out all the way to these small capillaries, arteries need a lot of pressure to do that. So that, the heart generates pressure to push blood into the arteries, and you know, that's what's measured when you go to the doctor. So again, the average blood pressure is given as a unitless number. But what that really is 120 over 80 is 120 millimeters of mercury over 80 millimeters of mercury. But it's usually not written. So you have to generate pressure to push blood forward. If there's no pressure, the blood will not circulate. That's why you need the heart. Okay, now people know this. If your blood pressure is dropping, you're gonna die, right? You don't have to be a doctor or a student in physiology to know that. But this is the vital pressure. You measure a pressure in your patient, usually here in the brachial artery, they're saying, okay, that's enough pressure to push blood to the capillaries so you can have gas exchange. So millimeters of mercury, if you take a physics class, they'll probably use different units like Pascal. But in medical sciences, they usually use millimeters of mercury as the pressure in humans. It's just basically how much pressure does it take to displace a column of fluid, right? Millimeters of mercury. Now, why is it reported as two numbers? I just told you why. It's in your notes if you came on time. What are the two words you wrote down? One starts with an S, one starts with a D. Diastole and systole, very good. Now, which is the one where the heart's contracting and generating pressure? The systole. So which number do you think that is, top or bottom? Now, I heard both. When the heart's generating more pressure, wouldn't that generate the higher number? Yeah. So that top number is the systolic blood pressure. We'll call it the SBP. But then the heart has to relax so it can fill for the next heartbeat. Okay, so when it relaxes in the arteries, we measure a pressure drop. But it doesn't drop all the way to zero. It drops just a little bit to like 80. So that's like the diastolic blood pressure. While the heart is in diastole, there's still a pressure in the arterial system. So that's enough pressure to keep blood moving forward when the heart's relaxed. So that's the diastolic BP. So that's the blood pressure in the arteries. Arterial pressure is a vital sign of life, right? We take someone's vitals. I mean, I'm not a doctor, but I know this. That's one of them. What's the other one? Pulse, respiratory rate. Okay, the vital signs of life. Okay, so you've done your job. You've pushed blood with high arterial pressure to the capillaries. You have exchange. Now, there's a big pressure drop-off. If you take an average of this blood pressure, it's about 93. they call that the mean arterial pressure, MAP. And you're saying, how come it's not 100? Why can't you just take the mathematical average? How long is one heartbeat? 0.8. 0.8 seconds, 800 milliseconds. How much of that 0.8 is the heart in diastole? I said 0.5 of the 0.8. So the heart spends more time in diastole, so the average is going to be closer to the bottom number. Okay, so if you want to express blood pressure as one number, that's kind of how they do it. Right? Usually you'll report two numbers, but point is, when you get to the small capillaries, there's a big pressure drop. You don't want high arterial pressure in these small blood vessels, they'll burst. And when you measure it, it'll be something like, you know, 35-ish milliliters of mercury. There's a huge pressure drop off as you go from arteries to capillaries to veins. Veins are the blood vessels that collect this spent blood from the capillary beds. Collect, quote unquote, spent blood from capillaries. And their job is to collect and then return all the blood back to the heart. Collect spent blood from capillaries. Return this, you know, deoxygenated blood to the heart. Now, by the time you get to the largest veins that return it to the heart, the blood pressure drops off tremendously, maybe just 1 to 3 millimeters of mercury. Okay, so it's the arterial pressure that's really high to push the blood out. And by the time it's returned, it's like not a lot of pressure there. But anyways, that's the blood vessels. Okay, we have other kinds of blood vessels. Like if you ever see the term sinus, today we'll talk about a blood vessel that's called a sinus. I mean, don't get thrown off just because they use a different term. Mostly they're arteries, capillaries, and veins. Every once in a while you'll see something called a sinus. All right, we have the blood itself. A liquid tissue that circulates. It carries oxygen because it has the molecule hemoglobin in the red blood cell. RBCs have hemoglobin, the molecule that binds oxygen. Okay. O2. It binds O2. It doesn't have to chemically change it. It can just bind O2. And it can pick it up as O2 and drop it off as O2. That's great because If you had to do chemistry, it gets kind of complicated. You just pick it up and drop it off. And if your blood is decent, it has enough oxygen carrying capacity to keep you alive. If you were to measure your hematocrit, if you have a column of blood, here's the top mark, 100%. And if you spin blood down, you could spin the red blood cells down. It's about a little bit less than half than blood. Say it's right around here. I don't know. Spin down the, it's called a crit for short. A normal person, as a percentage, the crit should be about 37 to 54. That's what most books will say. That's a normal range. It's a percentage of your whole blood. That should be enough oxygen carrying capacity. Okay, if you're going to get technical, you can lyse the red blood cells, and you can actually determine the concentration of hemoglobin in the red blood cells. Okay, and a normal range should be about 12 to 18 grams of hemoglobin per deciliter of blood. Okay, so these figures, whether it be the crit or the hemoglobin concentration, basically these normal ranges say, okay, this person's blood has enough oxygen carrying capacity. All right, so we'll talk about the heart today. That's just kind of an overview. The first thing you should learn about the cardiovascular system is how the blood circulates. That's a pretty basic thing to understand. And I'll start with that. And so in this figure, they put the heart as the centerpiece of the figure, okay? And you can see immediately you have two hearts. You have a left heart and a right heart with four chambers. And what we're able to have in the slide, with each heartbeat, the ventricles generate enough pressure, and I gave you the number, 120 over 80, right? That drives blood through this double loop vascular system. We can divide this double loop system of tubes into two main circuits, pulmonary circuit, systemic circuit. So circuit means blood pumps out and it comes back. Okay, so let's study the right heart first. Well, just look at the figure. What color is the right heart? Tell me if you see that. Red or blue? Blue. Right heart, remember, right is always the patient's perspective, correct? So that's the right heart. And it's receiving deoxygenated blood pretty much from the whole body, from everywhere. Okay. So the right heart is pretty much gonna be our pulmonary circuit. And the right heart, its first job is to receive deoxygenated blood from the whole body. Basically, that's what you're seeing here. So, if it's receiving the spent blood, you want the right ventricle to pump that blood to the heart, excuse me, to the lungs, to get oxygen. That's the basic idea here. And so the arteries attached to the right ventricle are called pulmonary arteries. And look, they're carrying deoxygenated blood away from the heart to the lungs to get oxygen. Let me write that down. Pulmonary arteries carry deoxygenated blood to the lungs, basically is what I'm writing here. The lungs are filled with fresh air, it'll pick up oxygen there. So the goal is to get that deoxygenated blood to the pulmonary capillaries, okay, in the lungs where the fresh air is. That'll do it. That'll get the gas exchange occurring. So I'm writing capillaries in the because if you do it right, you pick up oxygen, okay? I'll just say, pick up O2, simply put. So then it's the job of the pulmonary veins to collect this freshly oxygenated blood and return it to the left heart, okay? So pulmonary arteries, okay, pulmonary veins, collect freshly oxygenated blood and return it to left heart. So notice the only way to get from the right heart to the left heart is through the pulmonary capillaries, right? There's no blood mixing right and left. Other animals, you study them, there is blood mixing. That's okay, it's just not as efficient. Us, we got four-chambered heart, it's good, there's no blood mixing. Right to left is through the pulmonary capillaries, all right? So that's basically the pulmonary circuit. Now the systemic circuit, that's the main one. That's circulating blood basically to the whole body. So remember, in pulmonary circulation, the rule is for all blood vessels, arteries carry blood away from the heart. What kind of blood is in pulmonary arteries? Oxygenated or deoxygenated? Deoxygenated blood in arteries, right? Students always want to remember, oh, arteries always carry oxygenated blood. That's not always true.
Dr.
Warren? Yeah.
Okay, so isn't there like these two specialized, like for example, like there's a specialized artery that carries blood to the heart? Like one specialized artery and then vice versa for the pulmonary vein?
A special artery. I'm not sure what you're referring to. Are you talking about coronary circulation? I don't know what you're talking about. Maybe as I go through the lecture, it'll come up.
Okay.
For now, just understand pulmonary circulation versus systemic circulation. Okay, let's do that. Now, systemic circulation involves mostly the left heart. Now, the left heart, if you look at the picture, is basically receiving the oxygenated blood that just came from the lungs, right? Are delivering it to the left heart. Now, the left heart will pump that oxygenated blood through systemic arteries to the whole body. I'll say that they distribute oxygenated blood to the whole body. whole body. All the capillary beds of everything everywhere, and you distribute blood everywhere. So the systemic capillaries, again, you have gas exchange that occurs at the capillaries where you're just gonna drop off the oxygenated blood to the tissues that need it. The systemic capillaries drop off O2, so then the blood becomes deoxygenated, and it's the job of the systemic veins to collect that blood and return to the heart. I think I already said this, but say it again. Systemic veins collect / return this deoxygenated blood to the heart. And notice I say, we use blue, but it's not, there's no blue blood. It symbolizes deoxygenated blood. And notice it's not unoxygenated. You don't drop off every molecule. Really, it's only like, you drop down from like 99% oxygenated to like 75% oxygen. I mean, it's not very much. You still have a lot of oxygen, even in this systemic blood. But anyways, that's the blood that's returned to the right heart. And we've completed the double loop, right? We started here, went up there, come back, and then this. But anyways, that's how blood circulates. Okay, this is the classic picture in the physiology book where they like to show you a coronal section through the heart, and you see all four chambers, all the valves you gotta know. What's misleading about this picture is this is not how the heart sits in the chest. Okay? This implies that the atria are superior to the ventricles and that blood flows down into them, but that's not true. The atria are actually behind the ventricles. This is where I want to use the app. It'll give us a better picture of what the heart really looks like, and we'll start to get a better view. All right, so I'll give you some structures to look for in your models, but don't look at them yet. That's kind of more or less how the heart sits in the chest. And if you have a model that has a stand, not all of them do, but as it sits on the stand, that's how the heart sits in the chest. If you look behind the heart, for example, that's part of the left atrium, and that's part of the right atrium. Let's start our anatomy of the heart by talking about the two chambers that receive blood, the right atrium and the left atrium, okay? So this is a posterior view. This is a posterior view. Is this the left or the right in green?
Right.
It's the right. Very good. So that is the right atrium. The atria sit behind the ventricles, and we get that point on the board. So then blood will flow forward to the ventricles so blood can be pumped. So we've got right atrium. And we have left atrium. The atria, plural, basically are the blood receivers. They receive the blood so the heart can pump it. Talked about the two main phases of the cardiac cycle. Are you going to receive blood in the diastole or the systole? Which one? Now the systole is the one where you pump it. Diastole is the one where you receive it. Now diastole, Did I say the heart muscles relaxed or contracted?
Relaxed.
Relaxed. That's when you can fill. There's not a lot of pressure in there. So then, basically, blood follows a pressure gradient. If it's low pressure in the heart, it'll just flow into it. And then when the heart generates pressure, it's not receiving blood, it's just pumping it. Okay. So that's when the atria receive blood during diastole. Let's look at the right atrium first. Okay, I have part of it highlighted in green. See that top part? It's shaped like an ear. It's called the right auricle. And auricle means ear shape. It's basically a part of the right atrium. Now, it's called the right auricle because of its shape. But what's its function? Basically, if these are going to be blood receivers, that they have to be able to fill. And when it's deflated, it looks like a little Dumbo ear. So these basically just expand during filling. All right, let's remove the right atrial wall. This is kind of what we'll do in your sheep heart dissection tomorrow. Oh, by the way, there's a dissection tomorrow. And since it's our first one, I want to tell you, or remind you, bring goggles, gloves. Be dressed appropriately. That's one day I'll kick you out if you're not dressed right. Goggles, and look for the sheep heart dissection on campus. I'm gonna make you print that out for me. I don't want to make copies. Just print it out. Print out lab. Get the print out, gloves, goggles tomorrow, sheep heart dissection. One of the things you'll do, you're gonna cut this atrium open, and I want you to know the blood vessels, the veins that are draining into this right atrium, because it's receiving blood, the spent blood from the whole body. Like this. See how it's open? Do you see how let me circle it, the tool. How this up here, it's like rough? Here. Looks like someone took a comb and combed the muscle. That's called pectinate muscle. It's kind of on the inside of an auricle. Okay. You should be able to ID that. Pectinate muscle on the inside of an auricle. It just describes the appearance of the heart muscle inside the auricle. Okay, someone combed it. Also see, there's three blood vessels that, drain into it. There's this one up here, that's the superior vena cava, and then there's a blue, okay, I named this one superior vena cava, name that one.
Inferior
vena cava. Those are two main blood vessels that drain deoxygenated blood to this chamber from the whole body. There's a third structure in there. Now, do you see that hole? It's wide open there. Okay, that's the orifice of the coronary sinus. That's draining deoxygenated blood from the heart muscle itself. Okay, so those are three things that drain deoxygenated blood to the right atrium. You should be able to find those. Let me write them down here. So you got superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, coronary sinus. I'll say orifice of. Coronary sinus. Remember, it's sinus, it's a blood vessel, just a different kind of a word. There's also another structure here we usually have students identify. It's called the fossa ovalis. It's a depression in the atrial wall there. Now I have a highlight in green. You see that? That little depression is a remnant of fetal circulation. It should close when you give birth and take your first breath. Fossa ovalis. A remnant of fetal circulation. I'll teach you fetal circulation later. For now, just note it. Okay, that's pretty much right atrium. Let's look at left atrium, and then I'll let you look at it on the models I put in front of you. We got different kinds of models. Whatever I just stuck in front of you today, that's what you're stuck with today. But study everything else during the lab time. So I'm going to turn it around here. That's the right side. Let's go to the left side. There you go. There's a posterior view of the left atrium. Let me kind of circle the whole thing. It's all that. What I have boxed there. And basically, do you see how there's four tubes draining blood into it? And what color are the four tubes? They are red. And what does that mean? Oxygenated blood. Where did that blood get the oxygen from? The lungs. So what do we call them? Pulmonary veins. And there's four of them. It looks like we have two on this side and two on this side. Which side is this, right or left? Correct. That's the right. That's the left. So you got two right, two left pulmonary veins draining into left atrium. Right. Four, two right, two left pulmonary veins at the left atrium. If we kind of hide that wall and look inside, we see some of the same things. Hide that. Hide. See this little outpocketing right there? This is the left auricle. Same as the right, just the one on the left side. Same purpose, same function. We also have a left auricle. And you also have pectinate on the left side too. Pectinate, muscle. Atrial walls here, so we can just kind of look down there. Hide that. So I've removed the atria. See how there's two gaping holes there? Let me just push one. That's a cusp of a valve. So now I'm going to talk about the valves, because the atria will receive the blood and then it'll just drain right into the ventricle through those holes and fill up the ventricles. But then you need valves in the heart to prevent the backwards flow of blood. During the diastole, you want the ventricles to fill, so you want them to open as shown here. Okay, but imagine these are topped off with blood, and you squeeze the heart. Blood would regurgitate backwards into the atria. You don't want that. So you want these valves to close. And basically, that's what valves are for. Valves will prevent the backwards flow of blood. Write that down. heart valves. Basically, a valve is open, allows blood to flow through. When valves close, prevents the backwards flow of blood. So when they close, prevent backwards flow of blood. There's four heart valves I want you to know. Let's learn two right now. There's the bicuspid and the tricuspid. Now, the tricuspid is the one over here on the right side. Named for the number of cusps, three. Bicuspid valve here. Two cusps, also called mitral valve. What I have highlighted there. It says posterior cusp of mitral valve. You don't have to learn the different names of the cusps, but know that there are cusps. And just remember jogger. Just remember lab rat. Left atria bicuspid, right atria tricuspid. Okay, let me pause here. I think that's enough stuff on the board. With your partner, you know, look at the model in front of you. Find all these things, right atrium, left atrium, all these blood vessels that drain into it, and those two valves, lab rat, the bicuspid and the tricuspid. I'll give you 4 or 5 minutes. Go ahead and look now.
No, I don't. but not my children. My children would like to have from a phone here.
She is. She is.
Like
your voice
here.
Right side, yeah.
The little one is the
Okay.
And the little one is the
Right.
they call the oracles, the ears of the oracles, their daughters,
blue with the red,
the
right,
the one on the left, the
you guys having trouble finding anything? We're going to reconvene in just a minute here. Did you guys find this one? Coronary sinus. On the sheep dissection tomorrow, you'll have to find it. And that's the toughest one to find for students. I usually have to help you with that. So at least find it on the model, and you stand a good chance of finding it on the real sheep heart tomorrow. And Dan, when you need any help, I can come out here real quick. Did you find all this stuff? I'm going to clear the board, then we'll start again. I'm going to do ventricles. So we got LV, RV.
We have left ventricle, right ventricle.
The atria receive blood. The ventricles simply pump blood. They're the muscle, okay, of the heart, the true muscle. Now, I gave you a number earlier for blood pressure, the 120 over 80, the high number, the 120. It's only for the left ventricle. The left ventricle will generate 120 to push blood to the arteries, to the whole body. 120 millimeters of mercury. You know, the right ventricle is pumping against much less resistance. It's only pumping blood to the lungs. And what are the lungs filled with? Air. You know, and air provides much less resistance, so it doesn't have to generate as much pressure, and that's good news for the heart. It just doesn't have to work as hard. So on average, the peak systole in the right side of the heart is about 30. Okay, now, how you tell right from left, do you see a fatty oblique groove in this view here? I'll point it out to you. When you get your sheep heart, the first thing you gotta do is, can I tell the front from the back? That's the first thing. It sounds silly, right? Well, of course we can do that. No, sometimes students mix it up. You think the back's the front, and then you start to try to identify things, and can you see how that's a disaster? So the first thing to do is to tell the front from the back, the anterior from the posterior. The anterior has this anterior interventricular groove. Let's write that down as a surface feature to know. Oh, I'll write it here. It's called anterior interventricular groove. There's a posterior one too. Oh, let me get one of them down now. Because if you can locate this, you're gold. Why are you gold? Because what is it called? It's called anterior. Oh, so we found the front. And you know what it lies between. It's called interventricular. So it's between the two ventricles. So therefore, you identify it. Let me see if it highlights it for me. Yeah, it does. So that's the groove, colored in green. Therefore, which ventricle is this? The right ventricle, and then that's the left. So that really helps tomorrow when you got your heart in your hands. Okay, what's the front, what's the back? And I mean, there's about 10 groups, and there's always one group that kind of mixes it up. It's okay if you mix it up. It's a little aggravating, right? So, oh, I wasted the first 30 minutes of that lab studying the back where I thought it was the front. Try not to be that group. So what you could do to look at the right ventricle is notice that the right, okay, you will notice right and left ventricle, they're not the same shape. But let's look at the right first. I'm going to hide the wall, open it up there. It looks like, yeah. It's obviously a little better. So this is the inside. This fills with blood. Okay, got the apex of the heart down here. And blood has come, that's our valve. It's on the right side. So which one is it?
The tricuspid
valve. Very good. And there's some anatomy of that valve that you see in the right chamber here. I'm going to try to highlight some things. You got the cusp of the valve. Do a multi-selection. So I've highlighted in green just the cusps of the valve. But those valves need these strong tendons to keep them closed. So what I'm highlighting, chordae tendinae. See these strings that are attached to the cusps? They're called the chordae tendinae, and they have muscles that help keep the valve closed during systole. I'm going to highlight those muscles. So what I just highlighted was called the papillary muscle. So for the bicuspid and the tricuspid valve, you're going to have the cusp of the valve, the chordae tendinae, and the papillary muscle. Let's note that. So the right ventricle. You got the cusp. The cusp. And then these little heart strings. Chordae, tendinae, and then a nipple-shaped muscle called papillary muscle. Papillary means nipple-shaped. So you're going to have it for the RV as well as the LV for the bicuspid. Also find chordae tendinae as well as papillary. Okay, we'll just stay focused on the right now. So right now, the valve is pictured open. Right, so these valves, they're open during diastole, fills with blood. It's systole when they shut, and that these heart strings become really tight, and the papillary muscle contracts, so that way the valve stays closed while the ventricle generates a lot of pressure. Now look at the internal appearance of the right ventricle. It's not a smooth appearance, it's kind of a rough appearance. And there's a name for that. The heart muscle with all these roughness looking, they call it crossbars of flesh or trabeculae carnae, the internal appearance of a ventricle. Let's write that down. trabeculae cardiae for both. Crossbars of flesh. You got pectinate, you got trabeculae cardiae. It's everywhere. Pretty much, it's all the rough internal appearance of the ventricle. Okay. They just call it trabeculae cardiae. You know, there's another structure. Oh, actually, I'll save for later. Let's stay focused here. Okay. There's another two sets of valves. I want you to know. You got the bi and the tricuspid. There's a aortic valve and pulmonary valve. See this valve right there? You gotta highlight it. That is the pulmonary semilunar valve. It's pretty much the valve leading into the pulmonary trunk. There's pulmonary trunk. That's the artery attached to right ventricle. And that's a valve leading into that artery. So what you should know is the name of the artery attached to the right ventricle, pulmonary trunk. Now, it's a blood vessel. Again, they call it a trunk. Okay, don't get confused. It's a blood vessel. Is it an artery or a vein? It's an artery. It's going to take blood away from the heart to the lungs. So it functions as an artery. I mean, what you'll see is that the pulmonary trunk, like a tree trunk, will divide into two pulmonary arteries, a right one and a left one, that go to the right and left lungs. Can't quite see that here, but just know that. And the name of the valve is pulmonary semilunar valve, so I'll write that down too. Okay, so let's talk about how blood flows into the right ventricle and how it flows out through the artery. Here's my 3D pen here. Let's kind of get a better picture here. Okay, that's pretty cool. Blood will flow in through the tricuspid. Oh, what's the wrong pen? Hold on. Sorry. Blood will flow in through the tricuspid. And then it's going to take a U-turn and go up and out through the pulmonary valve or pulmonary semilunar valve. Done. That worked out okay. The point is, I want you to see the inflow tract and the outflow tract. Turn the lights off. Blood flows in this way. I'm not sure my notification's off, sorry. Turn those off later. Blood flows in this way and flows up and out that way. Okay, what valve is this that's open? This is the tricuspid valve. Blood flows in there, makes a U-turn, flows up and out there. What's the name of that valve?
The semilunar valve.
Yeah, it's a semilunar valve. You can call it pulmonary valve. The full name is pulmonary semilunar valve. And, what's the name of this artery?
Pulmonary trunk.
Pulmonary trunk. You can call it pulmonary artery, you probably get that right. I want to look at the left ventricle. Go here. Hide that. So that's like the left side. Okay? I highlighted one cusp here. What vowel is this?
The bicuspid.
The bicuspid. Let's look for the aortic vowel or the aortic semilunar vowel. It's always out of sight. It's like up there. What I like about this app is I can kind of rotate things and zoom in. Do you see it now? See that? That's the aortic semilunar vowel. Let me highlight it in green for those of you that didn't catch that. Yeah, this is right inside the left ventricle right now. You are correct. That's kind of the view here. Blood flows in through the bicuspid valve. Okay, it's going to flow, and it's going to flow up and out there through the aortic valve. Hard to see. It's out of sight right now. It's right there. If you take your anterior view of the heart, we identify this as what? Superior vena cava. This is the most anterior artery. What do we call this? The pulmonary trunk or pulmonary artery. This is the aorta. It first ascends and it arches over, but that's the aorta. So that valve is like, it's hard to see. It's in there. Okay, so let's note on the other side, the bicuspid and the aortic valve. Bicuspid or mitral valve, that's where blood flows into the ventricle. During systole, it pumps it out through aortic semilunar valve. There's also another structure from fetal circulation that we have students identify on the sheep heart, as well as our models. See that thing highlighted in green? It's a structure, it's a ligament between the pulmonary artery or pulmonary trunk and aorta. Because in fetal circulation, it's like, well, is baby breathing inside the amnion? I didn't teach that, you should know it. What do you think? It's like filled with water. Are you breathing? No. So you don't really have to fully circulate blood to the lungs. Baby's not breathing. Oxygen's coming from mom in the umbilical vein, right? So you can kind of bypass the lungs, and so blood normally would flow to the lungs in an adult. In a baby, a lot of the blood just goes right from here to there, and you skip the lungs, don't you? You're headed to the lungs. Oh wait, no, I'm not. I'm going right to the aorta. So that's called the ligamentum arteriosum, because in adults it closes up and becomes a ligament. So in adults, on your heart models, look for ligamentum arteriosum. You know, that's why underwater birthing works. You might think the baby's going to drown, but the baby hasn't taken its first breath ever. You birth it underwater, then it comes up for air, then it takes the first breath. Okay, and once the lungs fill with air, all these structures close up. That closes up, ligamentum arteriosum, the fossa ovale, it closes up. All things close off because of the pressure change. When baby's in the womb, it's like the lungs are filled with fluid. And when baby takes the first breath, the lungs are filled with air, provides much less resistance. It changes the pressure that closes those things. And we'll talk more about that in fetal circulation. I'm going to stop now. I'm going to give you another few minutes. Find all this stuff in RV and LV. It's going to take about 5 minutes.
Which is also
awesome.
It's just like this part right here.
Yes, it's for fetal hemorrhage.
How?
Oh, it allows blood to bypass the lungs.
Oh, it bypasses.
I'm going to go to the next one.
All right, let's reconvene. I want to go back to the PowerPoints here. And this is the slide I kind of left off with, and after what we just did, let's see here, is my presenter. Quick review. Four chambers of the heart. Let's start with this one. RA, right atrium, left atrium, left ventricle, you got an interventricular septum, and then RV. Okay, and you got four valves. They're pictured open here. Tricuspid, bicuspid. What's this one here that you can see?
Pulmonary
semilunar valve. Out of sight there a little bit is the aortic valve or aortic semilunar valve. That's the pulmonary trunk. Here's the aortic arch. Superior, inferior vena cava. I see two here and two here. Four altogether. What are they? the color red, pulmonary vein. So that's a good picture to study. And also, what I good to do now is follow a spurt of blood through the pulmonary circuit and then the systemic circuit. Okay, and that's kind of what they this figure is for from the textbook. Let me do that with you real quick. So I guess I'll use the colors that they use. I'm going to use blue to symbolize where we're starting. Blood is deoxygenated. You start with SVC, IVC, superior inferior vein cava, because blood is deoxygenated. You're draining it to that chamber of the heart, right atrium, so you can pump it to the lungs. So from the right atrium, they gotta go through the open tricuspid valve. To the RV. So during diastole, you'll fill the right ventricle with deoxygenated blood. And then systole, you'll pump it through the pulmonary semilunar valve to the pulmonary trunk. So I'll just abbreviate it PULSL valve. Pulmonary trunk. It's carrying deoxygenated blood to the lungs. And so you'll go through pulmonary capillaries to oxygenate the blood. All right, kind of half red, half blue, symbolize you're picking up O2. So now blood has been oxygenated. You need the pulmonary veins to collect this freshly oxygenated blood and carry it back to left heart. I'm specifically going to put LA for left atrium. Blood will flow through the open bicuspid valve to the left ventricle. So here we are here. Pulmonary veins, left atrium, go into the left ventricle. So open. Bicuspid valve to left ventricle. The left ventricle fills in diastole. It pumps blood during systole, and when it does so, it'll generate enough pressure to open the aortic semilunar valve. Into the aorta. The aorta, which will branch and distribute blood to the whole body, it'll filter down to the capillaries, systemic capillaries. All right. I'll write the term half blue, half red to symbolize gas exchange. And then pretty much the veins will collect the spent blood, and the vena cava will deliver it back to the right heart to pump to the pulmonary circuit Yeah, and that's a basic exercise you should take yourself through. You should be able to do that cold. Okay, that's the super basic circulation of blood. Now, there are other related topics that we teach. We also like students to know how the heart sits in a living person, in situ, right? In the mediastinum, that's the space in the chest cavity where the heart is. So I got a couple of pictures here for you. This is a cross-sectional view. You see the heart sandwiched in between the lungs. Here's what it looks like if you were to remove the chest plate from a cadaver that's been dissected. What you notice is you could barely even see the heart. In fact, you can't. It's there, but it's hidden underneath the pericardium, the covering of the heart. When you receive your heart, the parietal pericardium will have been removed. So I guess one thing we notice is usually when you put your hand over your heart, when you stand for the flag salute, you put it over your left. But really, it's closer to the midline. It sits a little bit to the left, but it's a little closer to the midline. And notice right here, a model in the room. Let me just kind of zoom in here. We have four chambers of the heart. These two are the atria. That's the right, that's the left. Okay, so this is anterior, this is posterior. So here are the atria behind the ventricles. So if this is the right atrium and the left atrium, what's this one? Right ventricle, left ventricle. Okay, so do you see how the right heart is more anterior than the left heart? So this is one thing I want you to see. The heart rests in the anterior mediastinum. That's the space between the lungs and the chest cavity. And also, the heart, the right heart, more anterior. In that space. So let's learn about the coverings of the heart wall as it sits in the mediastinum. It can be modeled as a water-filled balloon, and you stick your heart in it. Like pretend my fist is the heart. But this approximates the size of a human heart. Okay, and you shove it in there, and that water balloon completely envelops the beating heart. And that's a good model of what the pericardium is. Okay. It covers the heart. Anchors it in place so it's not moving around in there too much. So notice that the pericardium is a double membrane filled with fluid between the layers. Double membrane filled with fluid. I'll just say fluid filled. Because because the pericardium is a serous membrane. It says that on the figure. And so we call the two layers that cover it, the intimate one that's actually a part of the heart wall, is the visceral layer of the pericardium, and the outer one is a parietal layer of the pericardium. So the double membrane, the double layers are, you have a visceral layer and a parietal layer. Both are serous membranes. That means they secrete the fluid that's in the pericardial cavity. That's what you call it. So the pericardial cavity is basically, in this analogy, the water in the balloon. Okay. Cavity. I mean, it's kind of exaggerated in the picture. Really, we're only talking like maybe a millimeter thick. It's not very big, right? Contains serous fluid. So we got a lot of terms there. The pericardium is the membrane itself, the visceral and the parietal. Cavities is just a fluid-filled space. A lot of trick questions anatomists will play on you is they'll ask, what's contained in the pericardial cavity? And students want to say the heart. That's the trick. It's not the heart. The cavity is between here and here. So what's in it? The fluid. Okay. I guess what you could say is the heart is in the mediastinum, okay, or the chest cavity, something like that, but not the pericardial cavity. Now, what we learn from this picture here is we learn how the pericardium, it covers the heart, but it kind of attaches to, there's a fibrous part that attaches to the great vessels of the heart superiorly, right here. Right? Inferiorly, the diaphragm is underneath there. Okay. The diaphragm is how the pericardium attaches the heart inferiorly. Let's move that down. So the pericardium has a, if you look at the figure of this, fibrous part of the parietal layer. I'll just say fibrous part that firmly attaches to the great vessels of the heart. Vessels of the heart that also attaches inferiorly at the diaphragm. I'll say as well as the diaphragm. Your breathing muscle, that one, that diaphragm. So the pericardium does a good job holding the heart in place in your chest, and because the cavity is fluid-filled, as the heart beats, it creates a frictionless environment, so there's no rubbing of tissues. And it also, because it has a firm membrane around it, the heart cannot overfill with blood during diastole. That's good. I guess medically, you could bleed into, with some trauma, you could bleed into this space. That would not be good. That's called a cardiac tamponade. tampon for female hygiene, you bleed into it. So tamponade, you bleed into the space. That's not good. If you're bleeding into the space around the heart, you're crushing the heart. It makes it difficult to fill with blood. This is a clinical situation where you would bleed into it from trauma or whatever. Yeah. Yes, bleed into the pericardial cavity. What I like about this picture is it shows you how the pericardium, when it attaches to the great vessels, and I guess I should define great vessels. What does it mean by that? Great vessels, there's three, and we already taught them. Superior vena cava, pulmonary trunk, and the aorta. Those are the great vessels that are attached to the heart. So if you ever see that term, that's what they mean. SVC, aorta, and pulmonary trunk. Consider the great vessels of the heart. What about inferior vena cava? How come that's not a great vessel of the heart? Well, it is, just you can't see it. Let me go back to the picture there. I guess they don't consider the inferior vena cava, they just want to talk about the ones in here. Actually, the inferior vena cava, you can't even see it in the chest cavity. As soon as it goes through the diaphragm, it's already in the heart, and you can't even see it in the chest. So let me write that down. It's a little anatomy factoid. I think it's even in your study guide. IVC has no length in the chest cavity. It's not in the chest cavity. It's in the abdominal cavity. As soon as it goes through diaphragm, it's in the right atrium. You can't see it. So the pericardium, the parietal layer, has two parts, a fibrous and a serous part, but this is all considered pericardium. Okay. So let me kind of list these layers on the board here. Call this heart wall, but we start with the covering over the heart wall, pericardium. But I'll list it under heart wall anyways, because this is the heart wall figure. Pericardium. The parietal part has a tough fibrous part and a serous part. Right here and here. The fibrous part firmly attaches. Notice how the serous part kind of folds, makes a U-turn, folds over here, and then folds on top of the heart wall. Okay. And that's actually going to be the epicardium of the heart wall. I haven't run out there yet. Let's first define this as parietal pericardium, fibrous part, serous part, then the cavity, the filled space, is next. Pericardial cavity. I'm going to start up here. Pericardial cavity, the fluid-filled space, is next. Then you have the visceral layer of the serous pericardium, okay? Also called epicardium because it forms the outermost layer of the heart. And that you'll see when you get your heart in your hands, parietal pericardium removed, you'll see the visceral layer. One and the same as epicardium. It gives your heart a nice, shiny appearance. You'll see that tomorrow when you get your shoe parts. It's shiny. As a bonus, I even have students dissect it. Let me fast forward to my last slide here. Let me show it to you. And I'm going to wait till the end. Took a picture of a student dissecting it. Do you see it? I'm pointing right to it. Do you see how it looks like clear? And it's hard to separate from the bulk of a muscle. So that's why it's a bonus. Not everyone can do it. All right. Usually students, they try to do it. I'm like, that's not good enough. This is good enough. Students saw that last year and they're like, okay, well, I can now do that, student. That was the best one I saw in life. Look how big that is. It takes a very steady hand to get it off there. It's really difficult to do. So anyways, that's that layer. When it's on the heart, it looks shiny. It's very thin. Okay, let me go back to where I was here. So the bulk of the heart wall is just the muscle, a cardiac muscle called the myocardium. All these other layers I'm listing, you don't even notice it. You just notice the muscle part of the heart. Then the innermost layer is the endocardium. This literally, it's touching the blood that's filling the heart chambers. Now the heart doesn't have nutrient access to the blood that's filling its chambers. It does have the coronary arteries that supply the oxygen-rich blood, but the blood that fills the chambers, it touches the endocardium, but there's no gas exchange in the chambers of the heart. The heart's job is to pump that blood. First receive it, then pump it. Okay, those are the layers of the heart wall. And I want you to see the heart as it sits in the pericardium, the mediastinum, if you remove the shoulders. If you remove the left shoulder and look in the chest cavity, there's the heart there. But you only see the artery on the left side. That's why the left side is called the red side. You see the aorta. This is the thoracic aorta. There's the diaphragm there. On the right side, if you remove the right shoulder, you only see superior vena cava. So know that on the left and on the right, you see different things. Aorta, more on the left side, and the SVC, more on the right side. That's the basic idea of what I wanted to get out of those pictures, trying to teach you how the heart sits in the chest. So the great vessels of the heart, I just defined them, three vessels, superior vena cava, right there. Let me see if you're with me here. Look where I'm pointing. Does blood flow down or up? Functionally. Down. Superior vena cava is a vein. All the blood drains to it there. That's one great vessel. Here is an artery. It's the aorta. So blood flows up and out. Here's the pulmonary trunk. Blood flows up and out. So, you know, arteries and veins are usually together, but blood is always flowing in opposite directions. So as you study these, always ask yourself that. Which direction is blood flowing? If it's an artery, it's flowing away from the heart. If it's a vein, it's flowing to the heart. Okay? There's some anatomy here I'd like you to know, these vessels. One of our heart models actually shows these vessels up here that drain the head and neck and upper limb. this is the subclavian vein, and that's the this is the internal jugular vein, and they merge to form brachiocephalic vein. Subclavian vein, IJV, my abbreviation for internal jugular vein, they merge to form the right brachiocephalic vein. And it's similar on the left side, you have the main vein of the neck, IJV, on the left side. It merges with subclavian vein on the left side. Form left brachiocephalic vein, the left and the right brachiocephalic vein merge to form the superior vena cava, which goes right to the right atrium, SDC. Here's a study guide question. Which brachiocephalic vein is longer, the right one or the left one? Which one is longer in length? The one on the left is. You can kind of see it as it's pictured, because what side is the superior vena cava on, the right or the left?
The right.
It's on the right side. So if you're on the left side, you have to go a farther distance to the right to get to that side. So. There's that. Okay, so know that anatomy for that drainage to the superior vena cava. Since we're talking about the chest region, the chest wall has its own drainage system. Two of the main veins that drain the chest wall are azygos, hemiazygos. They're going to drain right into superior vena cava. So note that. For chest drainage. Azygos. I think it's just OS, azygos. And hemiazygos. Chest wall. The azygos vein drains directly to the superior vena cava. Have that big heart on the stand, the Don Jake Sanders. So real quick, look up 52 on that model. Tell me what it says. I think I remember the right one. Shout it out. What is it?
The azygos.
Yeah, that's what I thought. So this is on the big heart. I don't think it's on the other ones. But if I want to get it in on a test, 52. It's right there. See how it drains right into the superior vena cava? It's kind of hiding on the big one, so that's why I'm pointing it out. It's like if I didn't mention it, no one would get it. Now you have a chance to remember. Okay, so I'm gonna move on. I just want to kind of give you some anatomy here. So basically, this is the chest wall has been removed. Do you see how subclavian and internal jugular vein, they merge here to form the brachiocephalic veins. That occurs right behind the sternoclavicular joints. Okay, now the sternum's not here, so I don't know that. This merge, that's around where deep to sternoclavicular in your chest. Trying to give you an idea of where these things are in your chest. Another point of anatomy is, this one you can't palpate, but there's a deep neck muscle called the anterior scalene. Now, it's a neck muscle that attaches to the first rib. I'm not really concerned that you know that, but be able to identify it, because if you can identify the anterior scalene, the subclavian artery and subclavian vein are behind it and in front of it. Okay, and I always look for that on cadavers when I dissect. It's another thing to know. So the subclavian artery. Is posterior to the subclavian vein, is anterior to anterior scalene. I wouldn't mention that unless we had at least one model that showed it well. I mean, do you see that here? This torso is that one in the back there. That's the muscle, and here's the vein right in front of it. Therefore, it's subclavian vein and subclavian artery are right behind it. So, okay, that's what I see there. Here's another model in the room. It doesn't really show it there. Now, when you get your heart, I want you to appreciate that it's already been removed from the sheep for you, right? I'm not going to march in the sheep and have you remove it. You just kind of get it like this, right? So, but, you know, at the slaughterhouse, they had to remove it from its pericardial cavity. It's good to know, well, if you ever get the chance, what do I got to cut to remove the heart? Okay, what are these two things? Superior, inferior, middle cava. Here's diaphragm. You see how the fibrous pericardium kind of attaches to the diaphragm inferiorly? I see four things here. What do you think those are?
The veins.
The pulmonary veins. Got to cut those four. And these two, aorta.
And then the trunk.
And the pulmonary trunk. That's what you got to do. Now you got this. And let's take a break. When we come back from break, we'll go over some surfaces of the heart.